I may have other jobs, but being a parent is my most important job. So, and you want not only to say that, but obviously to do it and to get educated and to see that there are many, many options available to you outside of gender affirming care. Do not take your child to anyone that is going to practice gender affirming care.
Firstly, can I welcome you to the Coalition for Marriage YouTube channel? It's a real privilege to talk to you, and thank you very much for giving some time to join us. Would you like to say just a quick hi to our viewers and our listeners?
Hi everyone. Thank you for having me, Dr. Rucinski.
It's a real joy to talk to you, and I'll tell you why I was so keen to talk to you. I happened to read your book, Lost in Transnation, and I wanted to tell our supporters all about you and all about your book, because I think it's crucial reading and a crucial reference. We, just for your information, we are the UK's leading pro-marriage organisation. We represent tens of thousands of individuals and groups across the UK and further afield who support man-woman marriage. We recognise other things take place in society, but we just think the way marriage is being degraded, the way schools are being told not to refer to marriage and long-term relationships is harmful to society. We believe the evidence that says, the secular evidence that says, it brings about the best version of the next generation. It's good for adults, it's good for children, and it's very good for society. One of the things which is a real stumbling block in our society at the moment, and it's causing a lot of confusion, a lot of distress all around, is this issue of transgender. And the pandemic of transgender, which seems to have come to light in our schools, among our young people, very, very quickly over a short period of time, much as it has done in the US. And I wanted to I know that you're a psychiatrist of much experience, and perhaps you could just tell us, first of all, how did you come up, before we start looking at the book, how did you come about looking at this matter? When did it strike you that this was something which needed investigating?
What happened is that quite a few years ago, in 2008, I was writing a book about sex education. And you know what? I was actually a guest at the House of Lords. So I spoke there about sexuality education. And it was while I was doing the research for a book on sex education called You're Teaching My Child What? I came across the gender material about gender, and I discovered that kids were being told that there is something altogether different than one's reality, biological reality, and that is called gender, and that is in the mind and in the heart. So gender is a feeling regarding whether one identifies as male or female. And students were being told, and still are being told, that this was going on more than 15 years ago. That students were being told, your gender is what matters. It's the way that you feel, whether you're a boy or a girl, that matters, and not the physical reality of your bodies, of your biology, and that the very idea of humanity being separated into just male and female, students were being told, is an oppressive idea. And that, you know, there are many victims of that oppression. And the victims of that oppression are people that do not fit neatly into the boy or girl category. And so I was extremely alarmed to discover that, because I know what science says. Science says that from the moment of conception, from the moment that the sperm and the egg unite, we have a new life. And that new life is either male or female. And humanity is divided into male or female, and that is permanent. And so this information that kids are being indoctrinated with 24/7 is not based in truth. And it's very dangerous.
The reason I think your book is so very important for people to look at, it's, first of all, it's a very long book. But that's to its credit, might I say, because it deals comprehensively with the matter. So first of all, you go into the, and we'll look at some of these things if you like. We go into the, you go into the research, and you look at how the research on which a lot of this ideology is based is fundamentally flawed, and as misrepresented as accurate when it's completely the opposite. You then go into looking at some of the treatments from a psychiatrist perspective, from a clinical evidence-based perspective. You talk about how they are bad, objectively bad, and indeed, we've had reports in the media of publications in the US very, very recently saying, talking about really poor medical outcomes for people who go down the medical route, for example. And then you do things like you give advice for parents from a psychiatrist perspective, from a counsellor's perspective, having spoken to many parents yourself. And then you give ideas for society and indeed for parents going forward, dealing with these things. So it really is a comprehensive book, and we'll only be able to skim the surface in our conversation, I'm sure. But I want to encourage people to pick it up, because you don't have to read the whole book. You can read the bit that's really interesting to you, whether it be the research, whether it be the problems with the medical approach, whether it be the advice for parents, whether it be the how do we get out of this mess as a society. It's fantastic in all of those areas. But I wonder, could we start maybe by having just a brief summary? You look at the research on which some of these things are based, and a lot of people in the NHS, the National Health Service in England, and a lot of our counsellors will say, well, we're following the evidence, we're following research. You debunk that quite comprehensively. Could you maybe give us a summary?
My book is not written for professionals. It's written for regular moms and dads.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
that's a really good ad. That's really good, because I'm not a professional at all, and I couldn't put it down. It was gripping. So yeah, absolutely. Sure.
One thing that I didn't mention is that the foreword to my book was written by Jordan Peterson. So it's not written in any sort of, you know, very complex or sophisticated language. Hmm. It's written for regular moms and dads, because I am seeing so many hundreds of families that were just ambushed when their child came and made an announcement about being the opposite sex and wanting to go on, you know, to medication and hormones. The parents were ambushed, meaning that they completely didn't expect it, and they just did not understand what it was about and how to respond. And so many of them made some decisions that they regretted. They thought that it was just a phase. They went along with it. They used a new name and pronouns. They may have taken their child to a gender therapist. And then later on, they regret it when they realize what this is all about.
Yeah. So, and some of the cases you spoke about were literally heart-wrenching. You know, you can feel yourself welling up just thinking, oh my goodness, people finding themselves trapped and their only option is to lose their children to the state. Absolutely awful.
Right. I also, though, describe a number of cases in which young people do go out of it. There are many people who have been brought out of it. It may take time. It may mean very difficult years for the family, but there are positive results. You brought up the evidence, and I would like to inform your listeners of something that very, very important that just happened last week. Last week, something called the WPATH files were released.
Yep.
And I want to explain to your audience what that means. So WPATH stands for World Professional Association for Transgender Health, WPATH. And it's an international organization with branches in different countries. It sounds from its title like it is a medical, you know, a reputable medical organization to be trusted. It is not. It is a ideologically based advocacy group that believes in what's called transitioning. You know, I try not to use the language because the language is really been so manipulated. And the purpose of manipulating the language is to change the way that we think. So when you use the word transition, it implies that there is some real change of sex, that someone could actually transition from being a boy to a girl or a girl to a boy, which of course is impossible. What you can do is take pharmaceuticals. You can change the way your appearance. You can have very invasive operations, once again, that change your bodies. But you can never become the opposite sex. So getting back to WPATH, the ideology of WPATH is to make medical transitioning available to every person, regardless of their age, regardless of any underlying mental health issues. And so they are proponents of medical transition for everybody. And it's been known now for many years that they are not a medical organization. They are an advocacy organization. And even though they claim that they are working with evidence, with scientific evidence, and they create their standards of care. You see, these standards of care that WPATH has come out with over the decades have been adopted by doctors, clinics, therapists, hospitals, and even courts. Okay, court systems. All over the Western world. And that's very important to understand because these standards of care are not based on evidence-based medicine. They are based on very faulty, low-quality evidence. And the doctors know it. And so what happened last week, and I discussed this in my books as well, but what happened last week is that Michael Schellenberger, who's a person on the left, came out with internal files from within the WPATH organization, revealing what the doctors and therapists were speaking about amongst themselves, all their concerns about their patients and how their patients were not doing well. And what should they do with that? What should they do with a young teenager who has developed cancer as a result of being on hormones? Yeah. Hormones that are given, at abnormal levels. You know, for a girl to grow facial hair, for a girl to grow a beard, and for a girl, a normal, we're talking about physically normal young people, they do not have any medical abnormality. It's important to keep that in mind. When they start this process of so-called affirmation, which is another Orwellian term, because you are affirming a delusion, we used to call it sex reassignment, but then the language, again, is being used to change our opinions and how we speak about things. So, of course, sex reassignment is not as powerful as gender affirmation, right?
Yep.
We all want to affirm young people. Affirmation is a positive thing usually.
Yep.
But when we are affirming a delusion, we're affirming something that can never be true. And we are misleading young people to think that they can change their sex. We are not doing them any favor.
Yeah.
So getting back to WPATH, WPATH is about affirmation at any cost. Everyone should be affirmed, even if they have serious medical or psychiatric illness, even if they might be psychotic and have schizophrenia. They at WPATH, they were discussing, you know, whether people can give informed consent, whether they need to be concerned about their medical diseases, their psychiatric diseases. And the bottom line is one instance after the next, we have to just make these treatments available to them. If they ask for them, no gatekeeping. They should just get these treatments. I did expose how some of their clinicians were on the record saying things like, well, of course these kids can't even fathom giving up their chance of being biological parents. You know, they're 12 and 13 years old, even younger than that. Mm. And this doctor, Dr. Daniel Metzger, who's an endocrinologist with WPATH, is saying, and I have the entire conversation in the book, and it's also in the WPATH files. He's saying, look, it always bothered me, but we have to keep the kids happy. And then he admits that the research is showing that these individuals down the line, when they're in their 20s and 30s, do have regret. Well, of course they have regret. Because the ability, the option of having biological children, to give that up when you're too young to understand what that means. And these young kids just say things like, oh, I don't care, I'm not going to have kids anyway, or I'll just adopt. They have no idea what they're talking about. And the WPATH doctors know that. And they go ahead and they sterilize them anyway.
Shocking. So not only can the children not give consent because they don't understand what they're giving up, but also the whole concept of do no harm is thrown completely out the window because it is actually harmful.
And they know it.
But nevertheless, a lot of them are here because they base it on some kind of research which took place at some time, which indicated that children, for example, are sexual beings from birth. And all that research, you point out very well in your book, systematically, with references, is flawed and is incorrect and should never have been relied on in the first place.
That's correct. I mean, the research that gender-affirming care is based on is a very poor, small study that came out of Holland. These Dutch researchers wanted to help what was then called transsexual adults, mostly male individuals who, from a very early age, were unhappy with their sex. You see, originally, we didn't do any of these medical and surgical interventions on minors. We only made them available in countries like Sweden and Denmark and Holland. They were made available to adults. And they were men who had already gone through puberty, obviously. And so these Dutch researchers said, well, why don't we help these people? Why don't we try and identify them before they enter puberty? These rare, rare individuals, at that time, it was one in tens of thousands of people. Mm. Very rare. And so they gathered basically 55 kids, mostly boys, and they picked them very carefully because they knew that most cases of gender identity disorder, what we now call gender dysphoria, most cases, if these kids go through puberty and they reach young adulthood, they will actually be cured of their dysphoria. So they will have grown out of their gender identity disorder just by going through puberty. They thought if they could identify the kids who are most likely to persist with their unhappiness about their bodies, and then we can stop their puberties and give them an opposite sex puberty and then surgery, maybe they'll do better as adults. Yep. And so that was the whole idea. It was called the Dutch Protocol. And to make a long story short, they picked these 55 kids with very, very strict criteria. They followed them for a year and a half. And overall, there was an improvement in their mental health. And then what happened is that the Dutch protocol was adopted throughout the world, even though it was a very small study, even though it was never replicated. There were attempts to replicate it, but they were not successful. And even though there was no, you know, our best studies in medicine, you have to have a control group. You have to pick another group that's very similar to the study group and follow them through the years and see how they would do.
Yep.
And they did not have that.
So, standard research protocols, absolutely.
I mean, the WPATH people, you know, promoted the Dutch protocol as the standard of care. This is what we should be doing with these young people. Mm. And the thing is that the young people that we're seeing now, the 5,000% increase, thousands and thousands of kids that are suddenly complaining about their sex and saying that they are the opposite sex or some other category, and they are demanding gender-affirming care. You see, those young people are completely different. They are a completely different population than the population of the Dutch protocol.
Yep.
So these are kids who did not have dysphoria, unhappiness with their bodies until they were teenagers. And these are kids who have a lot of mental health issues. The kids that were studied by the Dutch researchers did not, that was actually an exclusion. Kids would be excluded if they were autistic or depressed or had a history of trauma. They would be excluded from the study. And here, what we're doing and what the WPATH people are endorsing is they're saying all these kids should be given these treatments. In fact, they're arguing that the gender reassignment, gender affirming care will cure them of their mental health issues.
And you go into a lot of detail in the book, and anyone who's interested in the history of the research, the background of the research, and how and in what way it is fundamentally flawed should really look at those chapters in your book, because it's extraordinarily comprehensive and very, very helpful. That's great. You look at you obviously look at the medical approach itself, the flaws in the medical approach, the flaws around the counseling approach, affirmation only, and Abigail Schreier's recently released a book looking at that too, and how awful an approach that has been for children and society in general. But what I really love is the advice you give for parents. And I get a privilege of going up and down the country, Dr. Grossman, and talking to thousands of our supporters. And often I'm in a room with people who just don't know where to turn because they've got, and it is often an autistic child, but they've got a child who is identifying as the opposite gender, who believes they're born in the wrong body, and they don't know where to turn, and they're terrified. They're terrified of the school, they're terrified of the state, they're desperately sad as parents and wanting to help, but feel they can't go along with it. I wonder, perhaps we could spend a few moments, how would you advise people in such a desperate situation?
And you know, I'm very sad to hear that there are still parents who feel so lost and isolated, because it doesn't need to be that way. And my entire work is based on preventing exactly that. And I have tons of information on my website, miriamgrossmanmd.com, that help parents to not feel lost and not feel isolated. Because perhaps a few years ago, that, you know, that would have been the case. But now there are, there's so much that's available. And I would say, first of all, to these parents, that what you want to do is you want to affirm the child's emotions, but you do not want to affirm the child's beliefs.
That's interesting.
Beliefs are wrong, but their emotions of feeling perhaps uncomfortable about being a girl or a boy and unhappy with their changing bodies, those are real. Those feelings are real. And you want to find out where are they, where have they gotten the idea that they may be the opposite sex? Where are they hearing about this? Is it at school? Is it online? Is there an individual in their life, like a teacher or a guidance counselor or, you know, a neighbor or a friend or someone in their life or someone that they met online? Because I'll tell you something. You've got to, you know, you must get control of your child's internet use. And I have an entire appendix written by an expert on how to do that. Okay, the internet is just filled with individuals who are looking for kids that they can groom, kids that they can contact through different, you know, it's a downright wicked what's happening, because these adults are gaining access to our children in places that, you know, the parents think are just innocent chat rooms or places where the kids might be gaming, you know, playing video, watching videos. You know, these places may not be innocent. And parents have to get educated and get into control. If you're giving your kid a smartphone, which I think is a bad idea, but if you're giving your kids access to the internet without supervision, that is not a smart thing to do. And you know, you may pay a big price for that. So that's another one of my messages. So number one is to, you know, be with your child and, you know, learn more, be curious, ask them, you know, since when are they feeling this way? And, you know, where, what is it all about? What does it feels like? What does it feel like? And I'm so sorry that you're going through this, and I'm going to help you. I may not know a lot about it right now, but I am going to become an expert. Because I may not be an expert in this subject, but I'm an expert at loving you. And I'm an expert at protecting you. And you are my most important job. I may have other jobs, but being a parent is my most important job. So, and you want not only to say that, but obviously to do it and to get educated and to see that there are many, many options available to you outside of gender-affirming care. Do not take your child to anyone that is going to practice gender-affirming care. And I have a list on my website of places that you can go. It's under the resources tab, where you can get help from therapists who will not affirm your child as the opposite sex.
Great. And that's hard to find these days.
It can be hard to find. That's true.
Yeah. That's great. And in terms of as a society, we're in a bit of a hole on this one. You touch on this a bit in the book, and you have some great ideas. And I'm just wondering, perhaps you could help us out now. Where do we go from here? How do we shake off the chains, as it were, and move forward constructively as a society on this one?
Dr. Rucinski, I really feel that this thing is turning around day by day, and you know, it's soon going to be, we're going to put the nails in the coffin. There's just the evidence against it is formidable. I mean, we all know, those of us that live in reality and believe there's only one reality, and those of us that know that We cannot, each one of us, just construct our own reality. And we cannot, you know, permit our 5 and 10 and 15-year-old kids to construct their own reality and then accept it and honor it and celebrate it. That makes no sense whatsoever. What that does is it brings chaos. And that is the goal of the left, is to bring our society and our civilization to chaos.
That's really interesting. So you've moved on from what seems to be an obvious error in the research base and the logical grounding for this approach, to say, well, why is it happening in that case? Because these doctors and these other professionals involved, they're not silly people. They're very bright, they're very capable people who in other areas of life will follow a strict evidence base and look for proper research methods, etc., but not here. So what's the other motive?
Okay, well, here's the thing. There are many, many individuals that are genuinely thinking that this is best for kids. Now, why is that? That is because they are following the direction of their professional associations. And I'm not going to have time for this. Maybe we can meet another time. But I explain in the book that, you see, the professional organizations such as, well, here in the U.S., the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Psychiatric Association, the American Psychological Association, these groups have been captured and hijacked by activists. And so... So what happens is that, you know, your everyday pediatrician or therapist is going to just listen to whatever they're told by their professional organization, not having the awareness that their professional organization has not, has just swallowed all of this ideology, and that activists within the organization have taken the discussion, have taken it over, and they have not permitted any debate. They have not permitted individuals to stand up and say, hold on a minute, we are sterilizing mentally ill children. Maybe we should be talking about this. Maybe we should be debating it. Those people are not given the microphone. So this is very, very important for parents to understand that when they go to their pediatrician and they go to their therapist, they have to know that the professional organizations, not every single one, there are other professional organizations that have sort of, you know, splintered off. But most people don't know that. Parents don't know the politics that are going on beneath the surface. And that's why, you know, I present all of that.
Yeah, and that's great. And you do go into that, and you give prototype letters for people to write. You look through conversations that people might want to have, caveats for parents to share with medical professionals before they let their children talk to them, etc. Loads of really good practical stuff. Yeah. And then you say, well, look, in order to deal with this, we need people who are able to stand up and to speak out and to basically resist and say, no more, no longer. And for our legislators as well, to get hold of your legislators and to say, no, we're not going to just let you be in fear of the other side who will vilify you unless you agree. We're going to give you a hard time unless you stand up against it.
Absolutely.
And you know what? In that way.
There's a lot of exciting things going on. I was able to testify in Congress last year. I gave a 5-minute testimony that's on my website. People should listen to it, just 5 minutes. And this week, I'm going to be speaking at the United Nations. The United Nations is foisting this ideology on third world countries who do not want it. Third world countries do not want these ideas reaching their children. And so I'm going to be speaking to delegates, UN delegates, about how they can, how and why they must resist the ideology. So, you know, it's things are turning around, but the body count, I'm afraid, is quite high.
Well, thanks to you, things are turning around and people like you. I'm grateful for the time you've given us. I know you're super, super busy. can I just thank you on behalf of all of our supporters. Please keep up the great work. It would be great to chat again sometime, but I want to encourage people to go and read your book or read chapters of your book. It's fantastic. It's well written. It's very digestible. It's accurate. It's potent. And it really is going to make a difference. Dr. Grossman, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rucinski.